Toils away in civilian life with his days as the morally flexible mercenary Deadpool behind him. But when his homeworld faces an existential threat, Wade must reluctantly suit up again with an even more reluctant Wolverine. But before we go any further, I do want to give a very special thank you to the sponsor, Factor. Factor makes meeting your nutrition goals easier than ever by delivering fresh, never frozen, dietitian approved meals right to your doorstep. Their team of gourmet chefs create each meal using only ingredients with integrity to help you feel your best all day long. Choose from a weekly menu of 35 options, including popular options like Calorie Smart, Keto, Protein Plus, or Vegan and Veggie. Also, discover more than 60 add-ons every week, like breakfast, on-the-go lunch, snacks, and beverages to help you stay fueled and feel good all day long. So what are you waiting for? Get started today and fuel up for your springtime goals. And for us, Factor really cuts down on grocery trips, so it saves a ton of time. It's so much easier, especially with kids, to just be like, I know exactly what we're having for dinner tonight. We don't have to worry about that. We'll make it quickly. We'll be able to focus more on them that way. It just makes everything run so much smoother at home. So head to factor75.com or click the link below and use code STUCKMAN50 to get 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. That's code STUCKMAN50 at factor75.com for 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. Check out that link in the description below, and thank you so much to Factor for sponsoring this video. First, I want to talk about director Sean Levy, because this is obviously a huge win for him.
I like shopping for groceries.
He's been around for a very long time, I think longer than most people realize. He started his career directing mostly family television. He directed a family movie called Address Unknown in 1997. Then he went on to direct a lot of Nickelodeon shows, many of which I watched as a kid. Eventually, he found his way into the studio.
Is that why Deadpool and Wolverine look so family-like? And well, it looks very much like something that would come on Nickelodeon, minus the gore.
Studio rom-com world and did some stuff with Ashton Kutcher and Steve Martin. All along the way, he was still directing television and the occasional big movie like Night at the Museum or Real Steel, the first time he worked with Hugh Jackman. Then Stranger Things came along and he made a movie with Ryan Reynolds called The Adam Project, and now he's working with both of them again in a giant MCU movie, the first of which, as I said, rated R. So this is a very long build-up to what will probably be his most successful monetarily movie. And visually, this movie looks phenomenal. There's an action sequence that's very old boy-esque, following Deadpool and Wolverine as they wreak havoc inside of a bus. When it comes to the action, the movie does not disappoint. There's tons of it. There's fight scene after fight scene, another really glorious opening credit sequence set to NSYNC's Bye Bye Bye, which is also a fun bookend for the way they've chosen to end the film, which I won't spoil, of course, but there's a song during the end credits that also feels very much like a wrap-up or saying goodbye, and having a sort of jokey way to literally say bye to the Fox universe at the beginning of the movie, and then have ways of wrapping all of that up in the film. It feels like a really heartfelt embrace of everything that Fox tried to do with a lot of their superhero movies over the years, Deadpool being one of their last and greatest attempts. And now that he's part of the MCU, this movie wisely acknowledges and pokes fun at a very long and storied history of superhero films. But what you really come to this movie for, at least I hope so, is just to see Hugh Jackman back as Wolverine teamed up with this version of Ryan Reynolds' Deadpool, because both of these actors have had movies where their character hasn't been treated exactly well or the film didn't work out, but they've really found their wavelength for the character now. And the cool thing about Wolverine is that you can have a movie like Logan that's extremely serious, or even The Wolverine, or a film like this, where that character is the straight guy to Deadpool's insanity, and they play off each other great. At the end of the day, it kind of feels more like a buddy cop movie than an MCU film, which is fantastic. And of course, once again, without getting into any details, the film is really good at giving comic book fans things they've wanted for a long time, but also having the guts to say, you know, this thing you've suggested in the past, well, here's what it might look like. And then you realize, yeah, okay, maybe it is better to change some things. This movie has a lot of things that they have to set up, because you're bringing Deadpool into the MCU. You're also the first R-rated film that has all different types of language and things that the MCU has never had before. And there's fourth wall breaks, just like with any Deadpool movie, but it also has to set up this plot, bring Wolverine into it, while not messing with Logan, because most people really like Logan. And I can only assume that this movie was probably tested 1,000 times before they found the most acceptable route for audience appreciation, which seems to be a lot of people really like Logan. And I can only assume that this movie was probably tested 1,000 times before they found the most acceptable route for audience appreciation, which seems to be a lot of action, pause for exposition and figuring out where we are, a lot of action, pause to restart and figure out where we are, and that's kind of the way the movie flows. And it's entertaining all the way through. It's paced very well. Deadpool even kind of acknowledges at one point near the end that the film might be running a tad long by looking at us and saying, don't worry, stay with us. We're in the home stretch here. And again, without getting into any details, there are many moments in the film that made me smile considerably and that made me very excited, and some very fun ways at exploring things that almost happened that didn't quite come to fruition, and how that could be viewed through the lens of comedy. And there's one specific choice with one of those, I guess, fan-friendly moments is all I can really think to call it without giving anything away, that I thought was fairly surprising given Marvel's current history. And that is all I can say without literally spoiling it. I don't think this is the best Deadpool movie, but I do think that it might be the most...
You already did.
Fun, like in regards to just fan service and action and lighthearted, witty banter. It doesn't feel as perfectly structured as that first movie, but seeing Hugh Jackman back as Wolverine, even though I never thought it would happen again, it was just a delight to see him in that yellow suit and being Wolverine again, because it really is. I mean, really think about how long he's been playing this character. And I can only imagine, like, different superheroes like a Batman or a Superman have had all different types of actors come in and out of that role. Even the Joker now has had multiple successful incarnations. But Wolverine is so attached to Hugh Jackman because they just got it so right the first time that I can't even imagine whoever would have to try to step into the claws again. It just doesn't feel...
Henry Cavill, the Cavillian.
It feels so wrong, and I feel awful if that ever happens in the future for whoever has to play that role and go through all of the, well, he's not Hugh Jackman stuff. But man, is he good in this movie, and so much fun to watch against Ryan Reynolds. If this ends up being the last time we see Deadpool in a movie, he's had a fantastic trilogy. Ryan Reynolds has really done a great job to make this character the way he should be, because obviously he tried with Origins and really kept trying and got it right. And this trilogy is a ton of fun. It's a really, really good superhero trilogy. And they're all different in their own ways, which I really admire, probably because all three of them have different filmmakers. Obviously, there's a lot more to talk about when it comes to Deadpool and Wolverine, but I really want to preserve the fun for you guys if you haven't seen the film yet. So go check it out. Thank you so much, as always, for watching, guys. And if you like this, you can click right here and get Stuckmanized.
If you're a web designer, here are 4 Wix Studio features you gotta know.
Yeah, to me, he kind of already spoiled it, you know. And a lot of these reviewers are gonna say the same thing. They're gonna say pretty much the same stuff. But a lot of people are trying not to spoil it yet, at least from these movie reviews. And I'm not sure about how it's gonna be prevented in the future, because you know people love to spoil stuff on the internet. I'm trying to find another way to get food here. Let's see what the Drum Dumb says.
Well, it's finally here, the new Deadpool and Wolverine movie. We're gonna review it. Let's go. Deadpool and Wolverine stars Ryan Reynolds, Hugh Jackman, and is directed by Sean Levy. What's up, guys? Welcome to a brand new 2024 review. We're going to do the new Deadpool movie. Now, this is the type of movie that is, just chock full of spoilers. So I'll say this right now. It's good. It's really, really fun. If you liked Deadpool 1 and Deadpool 2, you will like this, I promise. Is it the best of the three? I'm not sure yet. It might be.
Big slow motion action sequence. Who knows if you live or die?
Let's fucking go.
I love Deadpool 1 and 2. And I think both those movies have their strong suits, things that I can pick out of those movies and say, I love that. And I love, like, Deadpool 2. I love the character Domino. She was so fun. She just had luck on her side. And luck can be a superpower, which was really cool. This movie has characteristics about it that you are going to love. It might be the funniest. And obviously, this pokes fun at the current state of the MCU. We are not in the best era of the MCU. And of course, this movie's going to have fun with that. This is kind of the saving grace of the MCU as it stands. And just to timestamp this, we just found out that there's two new Avengers movies coming. Kang Dynasty is out the window. Now they have Avengers Doomsday, which is about Dr. Doom. It was just announced that Robert Downey Jr. is going to play Dr. Doom. And then Secret Wars is going to be the next movie. Exciting stuff ahead. And I have my own thoughts about Robert Downey Jr. I'll definitely watch it. I mean, he's that great of an actor. But
everybody's been saying something about that.
Is there a little bit of desperation there? Yeah, for sure. But we're here to talk about the new Deadpool movie. I thought long and hard about if I'm going to make this a spoiler review. I will say I'll make it mildly spoilery, but I'm not going to name any names, all right? Because there's a lot of you that still haven't seen this movie. And some people, they just say, I'll wait a week to see the movie. So I don't want to be the spoiler review guy, all right, for this movie. Could I make a spoiler review down the line out of this? Yes. Will I probably do it? Probably not, okay? Because I got too many things on my plate. Also, before we get started, subscribe to the channel, all right? If you like what we do here, subscribe to the channel. We have a great community. It's really fun, all right? And I'd like to get to 100,000 subscribers. Let's see what happens. Anyway, let's give you a quick plot synopsis about this. Now, it's a Deadpool movie. It is a full-on comedy. Do you need a plot in a movie like this? Not really, okay? Is there a plot? Yes, there's loosely a plot. His mission in this movie is to save the sacred timeline, what's called the sacred timeline. He ends up in that world that we saw in Loki season 2. I can't remember the name of it, all right? I'm not your Marvel guru, your MCU guru. I watch all of the movies, but man, there is so much going on in the MCU plot-wise and character-wise that I have to write this shit down. But I do remember Sacred Timeline, and I do remember that it's a Deadpool movie that is going to make you laugh a lot, and that's really what you're here for. And we need to get Wolverine in this thing somehow. We know that Wolverine died in Logan, but they find a way to get him in here. And they use the multiverse as a way to do it. And that's a fun part, too, is him going and trying to find the right Wolverine to be his sidekick in the movie. You know, obviously we're talking about multiverses. Obviously there's a lot of different Wolverines, and boy, do we have some fun with that segment of the movie. Could there be other actors that play Wolverine?
It's kind of funny to think that Logan is, the Wolverine is Deadpool's sidekick, and it should be the other way around.
Wolverine, sure there could. But once they get together, him and Wolverine, their on-screen chemistry is phenomenal. And I was so glad that they finally did this again, if you remember, because in X-Men Origins Wolverine, you had Wolverine and Wade Wilson in that movie, even though he didn't get to become Deadpool. So this is them two beating the shit out of each other in a couple of scenarios, and also just cracking jokes with each other. They both have a completely different personality, and that's just really fun stuff. And this movie is hilarious, okay? I know comedy is subjective, but take that out the window. If you don't laugh at this movie, then you don't have a soul. It's really, really hilarious. I could not stop laughing at it. And anytime I wanted to make fun of the plot or make fun of, you know, something that was going on, I was interrupted by laughing. You know, the theater experience was anytime I wanted to make fun of the plot or make fun of, you know, something that was going on, I was interrupted by laughing. You know, the theater experience was so great. This is a movie you have to see in the theater because everybody was just roaring and having a great time. This will probably be the funniest movie of the year. It's a hard R rating like the other two Deadpool movies, but I found the fun of it is how it pokes fun at the problems that we're having in the MCU lately, and not just the MCU, but also it pokes fun at like woke culture, how we do that just lightly. There's like one or two jokes that poke fun, and it pokes fun of both sides. You know, it doesn't take a stance on anything. It just pokes fun.
Like Civil War.
At everything. And that's what's great about this movie. Now, I gotta say, Hugh Jackman, his performance in this is, it's insane. Like, you're just reminded how great of an actor Hugh Jackman is in a movie like this that's really just supposed to be fun. He still comes at an 11. You know, he gives his all in terms of acting and really just giving emotion because Wolverine is a troubled character, and the particular version of Wolverine in this movie has a very troubled past, and it haunts him, and it's really something that we've never seen before. Now, I'm going to give you a mild spoiler in here, and they do spoil this in the trailer. Yes, X-23 is in this. It was nice to see that character again, grown up. I would have liked to have seen more of her, for sure. There's a lot going on in this movie. There's a lot of characters in this movie. And I think if I have to poke at anything because, you know, that might be a flaw, it's that I would have liked a lot of the characters to have more screen time. I could have watched this movie for like freaking 4 hours because of all the characters that are in it. There are so many cameos and really some moments with certain cameos that do move the plot forward, but also they're hilarious. And I just like how Deadpool always pokes fun at what's going on at the particular cameo, and even poking fun at how long the cameo might actually be in the movie for budgetary reasons. There was one moment in this movie that everybody in the theater just lost it, and it was the I'm just so happy that I wasn't spoiled in this one moment. And it's something that I've wanted to happen forever. And I was shocked that it happened. That's all I'm going to say. But I was just like, what the fuck? That, I think I literally yelled that out loud in the theater, but nobody could hear me because they were all saying, what the fuck? That it happened. That's all I'm going to say. But I was just like, what the fuck? That, I think I literally yelled, I've wanted to happen forever. And I was shocked that it happened. That's all I'm going to say. But I was just like, what the fuck? That, I think I literally yelled that out loud in the theater, but nobody could hear me because they were all saying, what the fuck? It was that insane and that freaking cool. All right. And again, not going to spoil it for you. I want you guys to enjoy this without being spoiled. How I was able to avoid spoilers is beyond me because I heard even major news sites were spoiling stuff. Don't check out IMDb. The cast listing, they spoil it in there, all right? I'd say just avoid everything if you don't want to know anything. But if you've seen the movie, which a lot of you probably have by now, you know the moment I'm talking about. So yeah, I mean, I don't really need to talk, you know, ad nauseum about everything that goes on in this movie. I think you pretty much know whether you want to see this or not. It is a fantastic time. If you've seen the first two Deadpool movies, you're going to want to go see this. You're going to have a movie. There's a lot of characters that are with certain cameos that always pokes fun at budgetary reasons. There was one moment in this movie that everybody in the theater just lost it, and it was the I'm just so happy that I wasn't spoiled in this one moment. And it's something that I've wanted to happen forever, and I was shocked that it happened. That's all I'm gonna say. But I was just like, what the fuck? That, I think I literally yelled that out loud.
Is he talking about Blade? Surely not Gambit. I spoiled it.
The theater, but nobody could hear me because they were all saying, what the fuck? It was that insane and that freaking cool. All right? And again, not going to spoil it for you. I want you guys to enjoy this without being spoiled. How I was able to avoid spoilers is beyond me because I heard even major news sites were spoiling stuff. Don't.
Go ahead.
But if you've seen the movie, which a lot of you probably have by now, you know the moment I'm talking. Everything that goes on in this movie, I think you pretty much know whether you want to see this or not. It is a fantastic time. If you've seen the first two Deadpool movies, you're going to want to go see this. You're going to have a blast. It's one of the funnest movies of the year. If it's not the best movie of the year, it's definitely the funnest movie of the year. You're not going to be able to stop laughing. I'll just say that. And there are emotional moments throughout as well. And they somehow find a way to marry the two together, because you're scared that when you're feeling sad in a certain moment, you're scared that Deadpool's going to say something to completely pull you out of that feeling, but they don't. It's scripted very well, and they know when the laughter is, I guess, okay. And they know when to let a scene linger for, you know, emotional reasons. So really well put together film, I got to say. So I'm giving this, I'm going to give it a high purchase worthy, okay? Because I don't want to jump the gun and give it a Trapped on an Island, even though if I did, I wouldn't be mad at myself. But I'll give it a high purchase worthy right now because, yeah, there are a few little problems of the movie. But, man, overall, just such a fun freaking movie. Deadpool and Wolverine, it's going to be massive this weekend. All right, so let me know down in the comments what you guys think of it. Looking forward to hearing your thoughts. Also, be sure to come up to Killer Flicks, where we talk horror all day and every day, and on Fridays, we do Free For Fridays. Follow my Dum Dums on my socials, put me on Patreon. Become a channel member, buy me a coffee. Anyway, guys, thank you so much for watching. Have a good day. Dum Dum out.
Book, control, save on all things business travel with Navan.
I do not know what all he's talking about when it comes to that. I think he's talking about Blade, but not quite sure. I think this one is the one from the Critical Drinkle. Never mind the Resident Evil. Okay,
Damn, man, I can't think of many films that have got more riding on them than Deadpool and Wolverine. Not only are people counting on it to inject some semblance of life back into a declining franchise that hasn't had a major hit in years, and also to prove that superhero movies in general can still be a viable prospect at the box office, but it's also supposed to be a much-needed focal point to what's been a pretty underwhelming summer movie season. The question is, does it actually work? Does it live up to the hype? Can Deadpool possibly hope to exist in the family-friendly MCU? Is Marvel saved? Well, before I answer those questions, I'm very aware that the film's just come out and that a lot of people are going to be waiting for the weekend before they see it, so I'm going to keep this review intentionally vague and as spoiler-free as I can. I'll talk about a few plot details that you've almost certainly figured out from the trailers, but I'll keep the cameos and the major story beats under wraps. So with that in mind, let's get right into it. The basic premise of the story...
So if you don't want to be spoiled and you still yet to see this movie, especially now because it's Discount Tuesdays, I highly suggest you go see it on Discount Tuesdays. You can get a ticket for $15 and 3D IMAX. If the movie theater still has it. And also IMAX, you can get it for like $12 tickets, instead of the typical $25. As well as 2D, it's $7 instead of the normal $20. That's Discount Tuesdays. You check it out. And do not check out my spoiler-wee review where I talk for like 2 hours and pretty much break down the entire movie. Don't check it out if you haven't seen the movie. For risk of spoilers.
...is that Wade Wilson has hung up his spandex and is now living a normal life as a used car salesman. Yeah, he might not be a hero anymore, but he's still got his friends around him and things seem to be going okay in his life. Well, until a bunch of TVA agents show up at his door and abduct him. The fucking TVA. Pretty soon, he's brought before Paradox, who explains that since Wolverine died at the end of Logan, Wade's timeline is slowly dying and is due to be pruned by the TVA shortly. He offers Wade the chance to become Deadpool again and join the Avengers in the Prime timeline. The only...
So if you haven't figured this out, I just learned this today. The particular universes, they're known as Earth 616. That's Disney. Over 616 is Disney. That's the one with Tom Holland and Iron Man and pretty much everything. Avengers, Infinity War, and Endgame. Anything involving the first X-Men and also Deadpool, they're under the same production company, Fox Studios. And that's off 10,001, pretty much. That's 10, that's 10,001. And there's one more universe, which is well the universe that the Logan Wolverine that is in and the entire movie is from. You know, the one with the yellow suit, the one that let everybody down or got his whole team killed and went on a rampage.
The only catch is that everyone he cares about is going to get destroyed when his original timeline gets prunes. Naturally, he doesn't take this news too well, and his solution, in typical Deadpool fashion, is to kidnap a Wolverine from a different timeline and use him as a replacement for the one that died. Unfortunately, it all goes tits up and both men end up getting sent to the Void, which is like a giant garbage dump at the end of time and space. Their objective now is to find a way out so they can return to the real world and stop Paradox before he wipes out Wade's entire universe. Along the way, the two men are going to have to find a way to put aside their differences and work together to take on a rogues gallery of former enemies and a few unexpected friends who show up to help them out. Reviewing Deadpool and Wolverine is a tricky one because whether you enjoy it is going to depend a lot on what you personally value in a film like this. I mean, from a story and writing point of view, I'd have to say this is probably the weakest of the three Deadpool films, with a frustratingly meandering plot that just kind of drifts from scene to scene and relies on coincidence, convenience, and the villain being completely and utterly retarded in order to function. At 128 minutes, it feels kind of bloated and sluggish compared to the first Deadpool, taking too long to get going, dragging around the midpoint, and suffering from the same multiple endings problem that seems to be creeping into most modern movies now. The primary antagonist doesn't feel all that interesting or well developed, with no personal connection to Deadpool or Wolverine, motivations that shift from scene to scene, and the same generic destroy the entire universe end goal that's become a fucking meme at this point. On the plus side though, if you came here to watch Hugh Jackman and Ryan Reynolds hang out and have fun making a movie together, then you're not going to be disappointed. Jackman always brought his A-game to even the shittiest of X-Men movies. He's been playing this same character since I was in high school and hasn't missed a beat since he did Logan 5 years ago. He's just as brooding and intense as he always was, playing it dead straight no matter the insanity going on around him, and actually delivering a few surprisingly heartfelt moments that caught me off guard. You're always going to need a straight man to act as a counterpoint to Deadpool's constant jokes and one-liners, and Wolverine fits perfectly into that role. Speaking of which, if you were worried that the film was going to have to tone down the crude humour, swearing and violence to play in Disney's sandbox, then fear not, because the opening credits pretty much set the tone for the rest of the movie. Deadpool's just as foul-mouthed and crude as he always was, and honestly, I was actually pretty impressed that they managed to get away with a 15 rating for this one. That being said, the humour's not quite as biting and slickly efficient as the first Deadpool, a lot of the jokes don't land, and the script commits the cardinal sin of trying to push unfunny gags way past their breaking point, but enough of them work that you'll definitely have fun with the movie. And yeah, much to my shock, Marvel proved that they are actually capable of laughing at themselves a bit with this one. There's plenty of references to the MCU's recent downturn in quality, the general shittiness of multiverses as a storytelling concept, and even a few jokes about some of their more troubled productions which really surprised me. It's not often you hear studios straight up admitting that they've fucked up, and I'm pretty sure the admission had to be teased out of them by Ryan Reynolds, but it's about as close as you're likely to get in Marvel's case. Yeah, the film definitely could have gone in harder on the MCU's many failings, the pandering and the girl bosses and the diversity hires, but I guess there's some lines that even Deadpool isn't allowed to cross. The thing is though, the movie really isn't about Marvel or Deadpool's place within the MCU. It's much more of a love letter to everything that came before it, that crazy, unpredictable, experimental time in the early 2000s when studios hadn't yet found the magic formula for success, when all kinds of hopeful young superheroes and franchises tried their luck, all with grand aspirations to be the next big thing. Yeah, a lot of them crashed and burned in the process, sometimes with hilarious results, and kind of fell by the wayside as the unstoppable juggernaut of the MCU rolled over the superhero landscape, paving the way for a much more successful, but ultimately less interesting and creative take on the genre. A lot of the cameos in this film exemplify that attitude of paying tribute to the movies and characters of that bygone era who never quite made it, and honestly, a couple of them brought a genuine smile to my face. It was great to see them back in action after so long, and maybe get a little shot at redemption along the way. Ultimately, while I think Deadpool and Wolverine is a bit of a bloated, chaotic mess at times, and probably relies a little too much on its gimmicky premise for its own good, it's still light years ahead of almost anything Marvel have put out in recent years, and delivers enough laughs and fan service to keep most people happy. Is it gonna save the MCU? Nope, because I don't think it even wants to, but it does provide a decent swan song to the movies that made the MCU possible in the first place, and more importantly, it finally gave two old friends the team-up movie that they've always wanted. And when all is said and done, isn't that the most important thing? Anyway, that's all I've got for today. Go away now.
Yay! Yes!
Woohoo!
Huh?
That's right. Anyway, I think that's pretty good. I thought it was... His video is... It's less than 7 minutes. And this is what he's talking about, what are you, this. Finally one with spoilers.
Spoilers ahead. You've been warned. There's a joke in Deadpool and Wolverine. Deadpool turns to him in the TVA and says, "Welcome to the MCU, by the way. You're joining at a bit of a low point." And I think that was the most honest of all of Deadpool's self-aware gags throughout the film. So what did I think of the movie? Yeah, it was pretty much exactly what I thought it was going to be. A multiverse mess, a paper-thin plot, saddled with a lot of clunky exposition as a result of how, you know, daft the entire concept is. Wolverine is an anchor being in Deadpool's timeline. That's the X-Men universe, Earth 10005. His death in Logan means that the timeline is basically falling apart and it's gonna cease to exist soon. So Deadpool is offered the opportunity by the character Paradox of the TVA to join the MCU universe instead, which is Earth 616. Deadpool he's already been there, having met with Happy Hogan in 2018, and he asked him if he could join the Avengers. He was rejected at the time. So Deadpool travels to several different universes to find a suitable Wolverine who can help him save his universe, with some hilarious results and an interesting cameo in there. But soon after retrieving one of the Logan Wolverines, they're both sent into the Void, a reality controlled by Cassandra Nova, the evil twin sister of Professor Charles Xavier. It's here where the bulk of the cameos take place. So, again, more spoilers. You've got Chris Evans in there. For a second, they try to fake you out that he's playing Steve Rogers. But I could see the reveal coming, that he was actually Johnny Storm, the Human Torch. I mean, you can see his costume kind of underneath his shawl. Also, you've got Wesley Snipes as Blade, Jennifer Garner as Elektra, Channing Tatum as Gambit, Tyler Mayne has a brief cameo as Sabretooth, Daphne Keane, of course, is in there as X-23, and Henry Cavill plays a version of Wolverine from one of the timelines that Wade jumps into, just very briefly, he has one line. The story is convoluted, time-bending gibberish, of course, but it's mildly entertaining. And of course, what does hold the film together is the brilliant chemistry between Ryan Reynolds and Hugh Jackman. And Jackman's classic Logan pathos and angst, his brilliant portrayal of the character. I mean, that's the highlight. So he's a version of Logan who let his world down. He was getting drunk at a bar when the humans hunted down and killed the X-Men, and he then went on a rampage thereafter. And by the way, if you were expecting them to not kind of desecrate the legacy of the movie Logan, think again. The movie opens with Deadpool literally digging up the corpse of Wolverine from the end of Logan, speaking to his skeleton, and using his bones and claws to fight off TVA agents. Yeah, so that wasn't sacred, okay? Now, and I'm sure that won't go down too well with some fans. I'm perhaps in the minority here, but I think the second film was better. The plot was simpler and more personal, and therefore a lot stronger than the messiness of this one. But I do want to be a bit more critical here. The constant sexual innuendo and adolescent smack talk, endless profanity that's characterized Deadpool movies, there's so much more of it than the previous films that it loses any shock factor and becomes kind of tedious after a time. As do all of the myriad of, you know, stabbings, shootings, the blood, guts and gore. It's all kind of tiresome. And to be honest, I was kind of getting bored after the second big Deadpool and Wolverine fight in the car. It's all pointless. They can't kill each other and you know that they won't. Mm-hmm. I found the Deadpool and Wolverine versus all of the hundreds of Deadpool variants a bit of a struggle. I do sound old now, don't I? I mean, I sound like I just don't like the fact that we've become so desensitized to this level of violence, right? I mean, yeah, look, it sounds like I'm a bit on my soapbox here, but it's not meant to be a moral lecture, but there's something wrong that we're at a point where this level of simulated violence is played for laughs. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. I'm done now, okay? I'm done.
The ancient Egyptians understood that they could use sound to reduce their weight and the gravitational effect through
Now, speaking of humor, I didn't find this film especially funny. I'm not trying to, it sounds like I'm bashing the movie, doesn't it? I don't mean to. It was okay. It's like you see the trailers, there's been a lot of them. You've seen the jokes in the trailers, many of them. And that's what you're getting for 2 hours. Aside from one or two quips here and there, it's not really a very funny movie. I mean, self-aware fourth wall-breaking jokes and references to, you know, continuity and canon, you know, the looks to the camera, they can be clever without necessarily being funny. It's not going to have you laughing out loud all that often, if at all. There is a visual joke that will make some people laugh, which is that one of the Wolverines is really short. He's like a mini Wolverine. Yeah, that kind of works. But the one...
Yeah, that was a funny moment. They should have used more of him. You know, he could have threw him... Could have threw him at one of the enemies.
Liners are kind of lacking. Besides that, as with all multiverse-related superhero movies of late, the film relies a lot on leaning into nostalgia bait. You know, the surprise of the brief cameos as a value add. I was actually surprised that Chris Evans would come back, albeit not as Steve Rogers, like I say. But there are two other surprises for me. One of them was that the door is left open for Wolverine to return again. And also that Professor Xavier, played by Patrick Stewart, doesn't appear in this movie. And I thought for sure that Patrick Stewart would return in some sort of cameo. Look, I don't think the film is terrible. It's watchable enough. It's okay. That's what I would say. It's okay. I watched the second Deadpool movie more than once. I don't think I would be in a hurry to rewatch Deadpool and Wolverine. Maybe it's because I'm burned out on superhero movies now. It doesn't really feel like a film worth paying to see in the cinema, in my view. But I'm sure some of you are going to disagree on that point. It's okay. It's not saddled with the message, at least. It's better than Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. It's better than the likes of the Marvels. It's obviously, you know, highly self-deprecating. But this is not the film that rescues the MCU. That's not to say the film isn't going to make a lot of money at the box office. I suspect it will. But Deadpool movies can only ever be a rare thing. You can't sustain an entire franchise on these kinds of self-aware comedies. Having listened back to this review, it does sound like I'm being a bit of a downer, doesn't it? Sounds like because, you know, generally the film is being well received, so I'm definitely in the minority in my criticisms. But it feels to me like a popcorn affair. I think that's what it is. I think you might be entertained the first time you watch it. I don't think you're going to be in a hurry to watch it again. It feels like watching... It has the same kind of impact as watching something like a Fast and Furious movie. So it's like a Fast and Furious movie in terms of vibe set in a superhero universe. That's what it feels like to me. Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Thank you very much for watching. Subscribe to the channel. Hit the like button. Share the video. Take care. I'll see you next time. Bye-bye.
Is that about a quick? Yeah, let's watch a little bit of somebody else. Guess we'll check out. I don't know if I should check out Noah Dwadok or not. Probably going to save him for a little bit. To see what the Critical Drinkers afterthoughts are, copy the link. That's interesting. Save that for later.
Adventure. It's not something we get every day.
Or is it?
Ignore the
with the right ingredients.
We've assembled a multinational team to do this thing. To talk about Deadpool and Wolverine, I guess. We might as well just jump right into it. Now, I might suggest, because the movie's just out, and I don't want to spoil it too much for people, so maybe we try and keep it as... You know, spoiler free as we can and speak in general terms.
Good luck with that.
Would you guys be okay with that?
I think if anyone's been on Twitter, that's too late because I luckily saw it on the first day and came out, and Twitter was just full of pictures of people trying to destroy any surprise or joke
in
that film.
I think really the surprises are going to be in the cameos, aren't they? So maybe if we just don't name them, we'll probably be okay. But I guess I'm probably going to turn it over to you guys initially and just ask, like, how did you find the movie overall? And feel free to go in any order you want. I don't mind, really. Okay, shall I pick the order? Okay, go Reaper.
I liked it. I thought it was pretty decent. It's not a perfect movie. It's got some flaws, but I thought the fight scenes were really good. I liked some of the cameos. Some of the jokes landed quite well. Some didn't. It kind of dragged in the middle, but all in all, I thought it was all right.
Nice. Robot Head, what about you?
Yeah, I enjoyed it. It's a hard film to have problems with because it's just entertaining. It's so entertaining. That sounds a silly thing to say for someone reviewing a film, but yeah, the story has problems. There's bits that seem very lazy, but it's enjoyable, and they give the audience what they want. We get to see them fight several times, so that's what we enjoy. But again, same with the humor, I agree too with Reaper. It's some bits land really well, and other bits are a bit, that was a bit tough. But yeah, no, I enjoyed it overall.
Before Mahler destroys all of our appreciation of the film, I guess I'll just offer up a couple of thoughts. I think in terms of writing quality, it's probably the weakest of the three Deadpool movies. I think it tries to push... some pretty unfunny jokes like way too hard, but when it gets it right, it does it really well. And I think obviously, you know, Hugh Jackman and Ryan Reynolds play really well off each other, and I think there are some relatively good dramatic moments as well. Like, they feel quite heartfelt at times, which surprised me. And I think if I was to define it, like, because people were often curious about, like, you know, what does it have to say about the MCU and what does it impact that, it kind of doesn't. Like, it's much more like interested in the, not just the X-Men movies, but like those early 2000s superhero movies in general. It's like a kind of love letter to that era of superhero films, which is kind of a forgotten era at this point. And it even, you know, even calls it, you know, some of the people who were involved back then, the forgotten heroes. But yeah, I think overall I quite enjoy.
So that's what that was, huh? Talking about like Blade and Elektra, how they were forgotten heroes. They couldn't save everybody he wanted to save. Longed about us. That's what Gambit said. or never knew about us.
Enjoyed it. Like, I can definitely see the problems with it. The entire plot kind of hinges on the main antagonist being kind of retarded. And there's a lot of convenience to keep things going. But when it gets it right, it gets it really right. So overall, it was okay. Mahler, why don't you tell us why we're wrong?
I end up having to defend Deadpool 1 a lot of the time because I think when it came out, a lot of people felt it was a bit cringe, and it's often cited as like bringing in the insincerity era. Like, it's too, doesn't take itself seriously whatsoever. But I always felt that that was the, you know, that was the sell. It was in a world where everything was too serious. In fact, if you remember, Deadpool 1 and 2 had several references to how DC, which back then was like the grim, dark, sad universe, and it would make fun of it for that. I appreciated how they balanced the drama and comedy. I thought, as everyone did, that Ryan Reynolds was a perfect fit for Deadpool, and so he was. I liked his passion for the project. I liked that it was free of the reins that you'd find attached to many other projects at the time. I liked the violence. I liked the willingness to be experimental to an extent, but I also respected the format where they bounce between different timelines in order to try and give the audience what they want straight away, like an action scene, but then also try and provide a meaningful backbone to everything the character is going through, how he feels, etc. Deadpool 2 was a bit more disappointing. I still quite like it. I just didn't think it was as good as the first, didn't think it was as strong. It's starting to fray at the edges of what I think they were much more solid on in the first one. And so this one, like, I want to make clear, huge fan of Hugh Jackman Wolverine, huge fan of Ryan Reynolds Deadpool. You can see me on Real BBC saying excessively that the trailer was pretty solid, and I think there's lots of room here for a really meaningful look into the characters while also having some fun. And I'm always happy to kick Disney while it's down, which this movie seemed to want to do as well. However,
but
here we go.
I don't know why. Like, for a second there, I was like, you know, could try and sugarcoat it, but then I realized, what's the point? Like, it's just, you know, may as well just say it. And I'll open first with saying, I think this will be hyper successful, and I think most people will love it. However, I think, and this is after a thorough examination already, Deadpool was assassinated, Wolverine was assassinated, the cameos were sad, the plot's a complete fucking disaster, the world building's as bad as everything else in Phase 4 and 5, the characters are all hyper-retarded, the TVA is entirely nonsense. The comedy was a significant step down for Deadpool 1 and 2. They have the same self-awareness of someone like Boogie, where they do the thing and then highlight how shit the thing is. The comedy felt insecure, the drama was practically pandering instead of meaningful. Most of anything they tried to cobble together for any character was made out of horse shit and had about 5 lines per character to resolve with as much meaning as most things in Phase 4.
So you enjoyed it then?
It was a good time.
Honestly, as soon as the phrase anchor being was mentioned, I was like, oh yeah, shit, this film's going to be bad.
Really?
Yeah.
That was what did it for you?
Yeah, as soon as that happened, I was like, we're fucked. Because Deadpool's already fucked at that point as a character. And then I realized the plot and world were already fucked as well. And I was like, all I've got left is Wolverine. And they did not come through on him for me.
Wow. I mean, you understand this isn't the same Wolverine that we know. This is like alternate reality Wolverine.
100% I understand that. Which is why I wish we had the one they promised we'd get instead of basically Diet Wolverine from Logan.
Interesting. I mean, I think for me, the movie got off to a slow start.
That have basically died. 100% I understand that, which is why I wish we had the one they promised we'd get instead of basically Diet Wolverine from Logan.
Interesting. I mean, I think for me, the movie got off to a slow start, for sure. Like, the first 15, 20 minutes, basically before Wolverine shows up, I was borderline bored at times. I was like, okay, come on, we need to get this movie going now. Like, it just kind of feels like there was no energy behind it. And the
interview with John Favreau seemed to go on forever.
Yeah, and it wasn't
to worry me, that interview.
Yeah, and like, we're not spoiling anything by saying that. Like, yeah, like, Happy Hogan is in it just for a brief cameo. It's like, it's nothing major. It's just like, the premise basically is that Wade wants to, I guess, try out for the Avengers. He wants to try and join them, and he's not cut out for it, clearly, because he doesn't have the right temperament and stuff. So puts him into a bit of a funk, and he gives up superheroing for quite a while and just becomes a regular guy until the events of the plot capture him and put him into like a new position. But yeah, that whole cameo, that whole interview segment, it wasn't particularly funny. It dragged on for quite a bit. The movie in general, I think, is probably about 15, 20 minutes too long. Because I was starting to notice the length by a certain point. It's like, okay, where are we going next with this? There's quite a lot hanging around. Whereas like previous Deadpools have been relatively lean and mean, especially the first one.
What did everyone think about the cameos? Like how they were used, which ones were good, which one were bad?
A couple usually of them fits really substantive or pandering, and these were pandering for sure.
A couple of them really surprised me.
X-23. I think I used it a lot more.
And I'm trying not to spoil things here by saying which ones are in it, but a couple of them really surprised me. Like, wow, I didn't know that person was even willing to come back and do this stuff anymore. And in one case, like, I didn't know that person was even still an actor anymore. So
I know you mean.
Damn. a couple of them, I looked at them and thought, like, you've kind of still got it when it came to the fight scenes and shit. Like, I'd be interested in seeing this older version of that character, you know?
I was surprised myself how happy I was to see that person walk into a room. Glad I didn't know who was coming up, like who was about to appear in, you know, all the cameos. So I think I'd gone without seeing any of them. When that actor walked in, the one that we all thought had stopped acting, I was surprised how good I felt about that. And I thought I'd like to see him again.
Yep. That would have been pretty cool. But there was a little, I'm trying to be vague, but there was a little joke about like the troubled production history of one of Marvel's movies that I thought was really good. I guess this is like a broader point that I wanted to make. Like it showed that Marvel is not above laughing at itself. And some of its shortcomings, particularly with the multiverse stuff, like the movie just straight up goes in on that. Like, this is so garbage. Well,
what does he say to Wolverine? He goes, "You've come in when it's at its lowest point."
Yeah. Yep.
They're spoiling it.
I liked attractive Deadpool. I only liked the stuff since Endgame, I think he said, didn't he? Something about that at one stage.
Yeah. Yeah. I think it probably could have gone a little harder. Like, I feel like Deadpool 1 would have been way more ruthless about how shit the MCU is now. This was kind of a toned down, tamer version of it. But even then, like, the fact that they're willing to acknowledge some of their shortcomings was nice. It was nice to see that.
But do you think that's because the film's so, like, because the MCU's in such a state, they went, we have absolutely nothing to lose. We're gambling everything on this film.
I don't know if it was like Ryan Reynolds pushing for this and basically saying, like, we can't make Deadpool work. Like, we can't bring Deadpool into the MCU.
Let him speak.
You and not have him comment on how stupid it is now and how boring it is. Like, because imagine if he came in and it's like, oh, I'm so excited to be part of this. It's an awesome universe, you know.
I think Kevin Feige is a visionary director. I think he's just brilliant. He keeps doing that.
I imagine it all had to be approved, and they probably had to walk a very fine line with what they could get away with in terms of mocking it and stuff, because they certainly didn't criticize like the pandering and the politicization and the MCU and all that stuff. Like, they knew where to draw the line, I suppose, or the line was drawn for them by someone else. So it's a slightly toned down mockery. But it was still a mockery all the same, which was kind of nice to see.
What did everyone think of the violence and action scenes?
I like violence. Oh, I like them.
again, all the problems I have are sort of around the story, but the violence I liked. I liked the especially like the fight in the car again.
Yeah,
that was really good. Because this film's got loads of blood.
Yeah,
it was virtually like
that is literally the best scene, the best fight scene in all the movie, the fight in the car.
We're gonna fight again right now because the audience is waiting for it, and I can understand looking at Maul that could annoy some people, but that I like that they just went, we're going back into it again, and here's another fight. So
I kind of don't know how they got away with a 15, like considering how violent it is and how much gore there is. Like it's pretty impressive, and how much swearing there is, like it does not let up, and they got a 15 certificate, like that's impressive. And yeah, like the car bit, I just love how much they fucking hate the Honda Odyssey. Like they just don't stop going on about how shit a car it is, which I liked. Oh, Echo's here as well. Hello,
what was that old boy?
Sorry, I'm late, everyone. I was climbing up Ben Nevis, and I got stuck and out of breath, and I had to helicopter.
Hey, that's my shtick. I tell you, man, I'm walking like Walter White's son today because of that. Like my knees have gone completely. Anyway, sorry, we're talking about Deadpool and Wolverine. How did you find it?
Well, I went into the cinema, and there was like a high spirit to begin with, and then that spirit, you could feel it sort of ebbing and draining quite a bit. You know, people started sharing less, and I didn't really have that good a time. It felt like the film kept getting in its own way and lurching from one tone to another, and it felt like it could never quite get out of third gear. So it was kind of an odd feeling in the cinema. With a lot of the, the sort of irreverent and the puerile mugging at the camera, which felt a little bit kind of like I wasn't all that much into it.
I have a feeling in about a month, maybe less, time could be 2 weeks, this film's going to get shredded by the internet. At least for now, it'll be okay, but give it time. It'll be like a lot of these sorts of films age really horribly. For one thing, the CG is already aged horrifically.
Yeah.
Do you remember the part where they jump out of the bus near the end?
Oh, yeah.
I couldn't take my eyes off Wolverine. I was like, what is that monstrosity of CGI? Fake. Holy shit.
It didn't look anything like Hugh Jackman, yeah.
No.
So much screen time given to the Welsh Deadpool. He got like at least 20 seconds worth of.
I was very happy to see him.
But was?
Yeah, I think that part when after Logan put on his mask, the Wolverine mask, it looked pretty much, it looked pretty CG, actually. It looked pretty fake. And, also, with the whole jumping out of the bus, that looked a little bit real. A little bit. But it did look slightly off. Because I always thought that mask was, and this was from the 4 screenings I was, you know, been in. I've seen it. That the mask looked a little bit too wide, like the ears, the ear parts of it, that's the black parts that spike up. They looked a little they should have been higher, because like I said before, you got this, the top of his head, but then you got the things that come out of the side, they should always be higher, and slightly higher, but I felt like it looked a little bit too wide, and I don't know, then when I looked today, it was a it has something to do with the CGI. The CGI was just bad, especially when Logan was moving so fast. You know, so.
Is there one? I did not see.
Yeah, there's one that killed. He just shows up right near the end when what's his face shows up.
Right, okay. That's good, at least. I would have loved to have seen the Welsh one try to talk and just like.
That felt like the most. If you had someone get him to that point, it's like just one line, make fun of the language. It's like the best opportunity ever. But pandering specifically to me with that one, you know, that's what they did that for, and I still didn't like the movie. So crazy.
Oof, they couldn't win you over.
They did try.
Just a lot of reviews. Kevin Smith. Okay, Tom Gidoli.
Welcome back to the comment section. I'm Brett Cooper. Guys, today I have yet another story to prove that audiences want to go to the movies. They want to support Hollywood. They don't really want to support Hollywood, but they want to be entertained and enjoy movies as long as the movies and the stories don't suck.
I think we're going to finish the other one first. Oh, sorry, done. Okay. Sorry, Adam, you're going to have to wait.
Marvel and Disney, and honestly the rest of Hollywood, has spent the last few years pointing the finger at audiences and blaming the obvious decline in sales and viewership on their viewing habits. The fact that they're not progressive enough. They're not ready for the MCU. They're not ready for these kinds of stories. It's their fault. They just don't want to watch what we're making. Well, of course, we know that that's not true. And we saw a contradiction to that excuse last summer with Barbenheimer, and now we're seeing it again this summer with Twisters and the fact that all of us have that soundtrack living in our head rent-free. Maybe that's just me, but I am obsessed. I will go see that movie again. And now, one week after Twisters blew into the movie scene, for lack of a better phrase, Deadpool 3 has arrived and it has smashed all records.
Well, there have been
and
some
smashed the Hollywood excuses.
That's just lazy writing.
Before we dive in, though, make sure that you like this video, subscribe to the comment section channel if you have not already, and of course, ring that little notification bell so that you never miss one of our uploads. All right, so Deadpool 3, aka Deadpool and Wolverine, has been highly anticipated, but based on recent superhero and franchise openings, I don't think anyone expected this. They officially have the sixth biggest opening of all time, raking in over $200 million at the box office, and they are only just getting started. And like I just mentioned, this movie has been long awaited since the announcement was made over a year ago. And it's highly anticipated in large part because this is the first movie crossover between the X-Men and the MCU. And if you're like me and you're not big into these franchises, you might have thought, well, I thought that that was sort of the same thing. But they sort of are. But Disney acquired 21st Century Fox back in 2019, which means that all of the famous franchises like X-Men and Deadpool and The Simpsons, etc., are now all under Disney. After being Fox brands for a long time. So this means that even though X-Men and Deadpool are technically part of Marvel, their movies couldn't be made by the Disney-owned MCU or have any crossover until now. And the audience's reception to this collaboration has been extremely positive. One guy said, Deadpool and Wolverine was a love letter to 20th Century Fox's comic book movies. Another person said, Disney might have finally learned something. Great movie and just great fun that they are supposed to be. Guys, I saw comment after comment, TikTok after TikTok, just loving the film. And the through line that I see with the response to movies like Twisters and now Deadpool and Wolverine is people just saying that they were entertained. Like, that is what they're commenting on. Like, it was fun. I got to escape. I was ignoring the realities of the world. I wasn't being, you know, hit in the face with a bunch of nonsense. The story was great. I was fully engrossed. It was fun. It was.
Book, control, save on all things business travel with Navan. Navan is the platform where employees book their own travel, flights, hotels, and more, and see exactly what they can and
was fun. And that's probably in large part because our world is so screwed up. It was great. I was fully engrossed. It was fun. It was fun. And that's probably in large part because our world is so screwed up right now and is so chaotic. So that really is what people want. And this response immediately made me think that Deadpool and Wolverine was probably clear of any woke garbage that Disney has been force feeding us for years, which obviously was a concern for many fans when this merger first happened. They just assumed that franchises like Deadpool would be ruined when Disney took the reins. That is a understandable fear. However, they have been pleasantly surprised. There is even a website that determines how much wokeness is in a movie, and the new Deadpool got a very promising score, only 10% woke and 90% based. Another commenter said, Deadpool and Wolverine is not only not woke, it is completely anti-woke. It was so refreshing to see two heterosexual badass male heroes in a movie again and no effing virtue signaling anywhere in sight. Just a great movie. Disney, don't F this up. It is so comical to me though, that having just two normal male heroes is a sign of somebody being base. It's like when a woman gets married at a younger age and we're like, oh my God, that's so amazing. She's so base. It's like, how have we twisted ourselves up so much that like, that's completely normal. That should be normal. And now it's this.
Wait, is she talking about herself? Because Brett Cooper actually just got married. I wonder why her last name is still Cooper. She just got married. Let me look it up. Brett Cooper, husband. Yep, Brett Cooper is married to Alex Tomlin. They tied the knot in a Nashville chapel, surrounded by friends and family. Why does she still have the last name Cooper? Her last name should be Tobel. We'll check Wikipedia just in case. Let's see. Married 2024. Yeah, I think she's talking about herself, actually, because she's married to one of those women that is kind of base. I think, anyway.
Sign of people being on our side of the political aisle or, you know, signaling something more than just being straight and being a hero in a movie or just getting married when you want to get married. Sorry, that was kind of a weird tangent, but it reminded me of that. Anyway, even though much of the audience has been saying that this is anti-woke while I was researching if this new Deadpool was actually considered woke, I did stumble upon this little article. Deadpool and Wolverine is the unapologetically gay movie Marvel and Disney keep claiming they want to make. Okay, very, very classic. Here we go. And this whole thing just made me laugh because the LGBTQ army, if we want to call them that, is just so desperate to find a way for every movie or celebrity to just be like them or be secretly gay, no matter what hoops they have to jump through. And the further that I dove into this Deadpool world and into that article, I did learn that according to some comic book nerds, there are storylines or lores in which Deadpool is bi or pan or something. He's something that fits him into that little community. Like one person said, you know that Deadpool is canonically pansexual, right? Okay, but in the movie that we're all talking about, Deadpool has a girlfriend, and he's just a sexual character in general. Like, that's kind of the whole premise of his character. He's crude, he makes sex jokes about every living, breathing thing that's around him. That's like part of the DNA of his character at this point. I mean, the best example that I can give of this is how so many of you guys, like, intrinsically connect me with Rough Greens now, even though we're totally separate entities, but I do love them. Rough Greens is a supplement that contains all the necessary vitamins, minerals, probiotics, omega oils, digestive enzymes, and antioxidants that your dogs need. And what I love, you've been buying. Been raped so that. Much really goes for you. Like Dr. Dyer's had free sure jumpstart. Like so go to rough money happens every single day. So it's not nearly as exciting or new as this X-Men MCU crossover is what I have now learned thanks to the internet. And if anything, the movie just makes endless gay jokes, which many like happens every single day. So it's not nearly as exciting like Brett Rough Green's my dog today. It really is funny how many posts I get tagged in that are just like Brett Rough Green's crossovers. That crossover happens every single day. So it's not nearly as exciting or new as this X-Men MCU crossover is what I have now learned thanks to the internet. And if anything, the movie just makes endless gay jokes, which many, like the author of that article, took to mean that Deadpool is actually making jokes to hide his true self as a bisexual or a pansexual. He's projecting, he's just trying to cover himself up. Of course, classic.
This might be hard to believe, but are you aware that nobody gives a shit?
But regardless of how certain communities or people with certain ideologies want to see themselves in this movie, there is no explicit or obnoxious agenda. And as always, just so we're on the same page here, it's art. So for that community, it is their right to view the film however they want to. They can interpret it however they want. That's their prerogative. But that certainly was not the intended heavy-handed message, which is all that we're asking for.
That's what we've been waiting for!
I mean, if anything, Ryan Reynolds made it clear that he did not want any of that put into his beloved franchise. I mean, he's smart. And if he learned anything from the likes of Top Gun and Twisters, the lack of a heavy-handed progressive agenda can clearly dictate a movie's possible success. And perhaps the lack of a heavy-handed progressive agenda smart. And if he learned anything from the likes of Top Gun and Twisters, the lack of a heavy-handed progressive agenda can clearly dictate a movie's possible success. And perhaps as he's taking notes and learning from Ryan, whose character has quickly become one of Disney's most lucrative acquisitions from 20th Century Fox. One Bloomberg article wrote, Disney bets on Deadpool, Wolverine, and dirty jokes to save Marvel. And they said, not that long ago, superhero movies could be counted on to fill theater seats and studios' coffers. But in recent years, a deluge of often indistinguishable Cape Crusader films overtaxed audiences, turning the once reliable money spinners into financially risky bets. Exactly. Quantity over quality, stale characters, remakes galore, She-Hulk. Do I need to say anything more than She-Hulk? I think we know what happened there. But then, Enter Deadpool, the antithesis to literally all of that. I mean, articles have literally said that Deadpool is turning all of that on its head. This is from Business Insider, and they said, the film serves as a litmus test for Marvel's new quality over quantity approach. They are literally putting that out there so clear. Imagine that, quality over quantity, crazy idea that that could work.
Just got a big think. Having the biggest think. Right now, boys, I've got a big thing.
Now, that Bloomberg piece that we were just talking about expanded upon all of that, and then they dove into how exactly they're shaking things up. And he said that rather than simply following the old comic book good guy formula, Deadpool and Wolverine director Shawn Levy seems intent on restoring the MCU to its past health by adding a lot more irony and snark to the traditional heroics. Your little cinematic universe is about to change forever, Deadpool says in one scene, in which he proclaims himself Marvel Jesus, which is just, like, so good. Ryan Reynolds, and probably everyone with a brain at this point, knows the importance of Deadpool-like franchises to saving a company that is spiraling into oblivion like Disney has been. You just have to do it right. You have to give your audiences what they want, which, you know, probably includes some amount of Disney ridicule and punishment for what they've been doing to audiences and what they've been doing to the MCU for the past few years. And in classic Deadpool character fashion, Reynolds literally makes fun of Fox and Disney in the actual movie.
One of my favorite things about characters like Deadpool and She-Hulk is the fact that they get to break the fourth wall and they get to poke fun at the MCU and they get to poke fun at you, Kevin Feige. So are you the one who's signing off on all these jokes, and is there a certain line that they can't cross?
They make fun of me? I think that Marvel Comics and our movies and just our own personalities, many of us in Marvel Studios, are very self-deprecating in our usual lives and demeanor. And Deadpool is all about that. Deadpool makes fun of Ryan Reynolds as much as he makes fun of anybody else.
And then we have a clip from the movie where they literally call Disney out by name.
Wolverine.
You're damn straight it is.
Disney brought him back. They're going to make him do this till he's 90.
I mean, it's just perfect. I love the breaking of the fourth wall. I love the self-awareness. I think that audiences obviously are responding to that. They have been on this journey with Disney, on this journey with Marvel. They've been blamed. The finger has been pointed at them. And I feel like this is a nice reset. It's a little release. So who knows? Maybe Wade Wilson will be the comedic truth teller that Disney needs to wake them up and bring back the voice of the people, the voice of the audiences who desperately want to support them. They just need good films to actually show up for. And after this last record-breaking success at the box office, I think that Disney has a lot to learn from Deadpool, so hopefully they keep listening.
Doctor Doom does not fail.
Well, guys, I hope you...
Doctor Doom does...
them. They just need good films to actually show up for. And after this last record-breaking success at the box office, I think that Disney has a lot to learn from Deadpool, so hopefully they keep listening.
Doctor Doom does not fail.
Well, guys, I hope you liked that video. Make sure that you like and subscribe to the channel if you have not already. And if you want even more content, you can follow me on Instagram and on Snapchat and on TikTok.
Yeah, that Doom by Robert Downey Jr. at the San Diego Comic-Con is getting a lot of heat, I guess you would say. And I plan on covering that, too. I plan on talking about it because I think it's... you know, pretty phenomenal considering the fact that Robert Downey Jr. was previously Iron Man. So, yeah, I want to talk more about that. But before I get off here, and I'm going to keep talking about this as I go, because it's not over yet. I know I normally do this on the weekends, but I had to kind of, you know, spend yesterday and today doing it. I'm going to have to go into this probably like all the way until maybe even this weekend, if not maybe around Thursday. Because there's so many reviews, and you don't have to watch them all if you don't want. You don't have to watch any, but I will try to include links into the description of each part. That way you can find the video yourself, but, you know, you probably don't have to if you just watch my video. I think I just do that for copyright reasons, because it's other people's content, you know, that they spend hours creating, so I don't want to, like, smash on their walk, you know, just to kind of get views myself. Without some type of citation or what do they call it? Basically like a reference page. Anyway, thank you so much. This has been Modest Mike. Like and subscribe if you want to see more. I plan on covering this and this movie more, as well as, you know, Dune. The whole San Diego Comic-Con fiasco that's been talked about on the internet for so long. Thank you so much for tuning in, and do have a good day. Come back and see us.